Hey guys, and welcome to week four. This week I have two videos. Sorry for the split, but I found that if I record through different software, I can show more of the videos. So I did the first half the same way I normally do, and then the second half is recorded in a different way. So unfortunately, two videos, but that's okay. We are going to have, this week's a little tricky because we're in week four, so happy midterm. We've got a discussion and quiz per usual. Now this video is a little bit shorter, so I tried to make it a little bit easier for you for the quiz and discussion. Your discussion this week is that we've looked at a lot of key players in animation, and there's a ton. You know, I can only cover so much. So who do you think had the largest impact on animation? It could be because of an invention, a skill, or idea. It could be somebody that we looked at or someone that you find on your own. Little tiny things can make a big difference, right? I mean, we know that Walt Disney pushed boundaries. Without him, you know, this class would take on a different kind of feel. But try to think of other things. I don't, you know, want everyone to just put Disney, Disney. So try to think of something besides Disney, but then in your response posts, you can respond with if you think Disney is the greatest media company of all time. Agree or disagree to that statement, and of course comment on what their original post was. Make your post by Wednesday night and then two responses by Sunday. You know, again, Walt Disney wasn't the greatest person, but business-wise, got things done. So really, really take some consideration with everything. Then you've got your quiz, both of the that's due Sunday, but also due Sunday. And this one is your kind of midterm here. We have a presentation paper. Now, this paper is going to be turned into a presentation. I will have videos on how to do that and everything, but you're going to write a paper on a topic in animation history. This could be about a specific person, studio, style, technology, location. I'm really leaving it wide open, but I want you to think about different kind of topics that are out there. The paper will be turned into a recording, and the recording will be part of a discussion board for all students to watch. You must have discussion questions that the class should think about while watching your video and discuss after. Now, the video and discussion are next week, so don't worry about those yet. I just want you to know that's part of it, so while you're creating your paper, you can think about it. You'll need to find a minimum of two resources to back up your ideas. You will cite sources in your paper. If you do not cite your sources, I will not give you credit for the paper. So make sure any words that are not your own are cited. I do not, it doesn't matter to me whether it's MLA, APA, whatever. Just make sure in your paper, you know, in, blanking on the word, shift 9 and shift 0, you put like a word to represent the website, and then at the bottom of the paper you use that word and then fully cite the website. Please, please, please do not do Walt Disney or the company of Disney. You will do research to find out more about your topic, then gather your research into a paper. I'm looking for quality over quantity. Make sure to go over your topic in detail. I do want to see more than a few paragraphs. Aim for around 3 pages. Again, though, I'm not going to look, 3 pages, A. It is quality over quantity. Put any copied information in quotes, reference your citation in the paper, and have a work cited at the end. Again, format however you want it. Similar to a normal class period, like when I, you know, go over some things, that's what you're going to be doing. You also are going to show a clip from the movie, show, game, studio that demonstrates your topic. So, for instance, let's say I'm researching stereoscopic 3D, which, you know, is how animated movies nowadays are filmed to be played in 3D with the glasses. Or you could look at how the glasses have developed. It used to have to be two different colors. Now they're clear, whatever. So I would go over the technical aspects, you know, where did it start from, how has it grown, what do we use, how does it work, blah, 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 who invented it, what was the first movie, you know, things like that. And then I would just show a clip. I could show a clip of a 3D movie. I could show a clip of how the glasses are made. I could show a clip of the person talking that invented it. Whatever you want to do, but you're going to have your kind of discussion and then a video clip to kind of show it even further. For the paper, you just want to put a little link somewhere to whatever clip you're hoping to use. And then again, next week, I will go over the presentation and stuff. So you don't really need to worry about that yet. But your presentation will be due Wednesday of week 5. So make sure you set some time aside. You don't have to show your face, but I don't want you just reading your paper. You're going to create either like a PowerPoint or an Adobe PDF with slides and just kind of go through the information that you want to share. I know some people are nervous about speeches, things like that, but this is, we're not seeing your face. You can always pause the video if you need a moment. Again, quality, I'm not necessarily going to judge your speaking skills. Okay, so let me know if you have any questions on the paper, anything, if you're not sure what topic you want to do, feel free to email me and we can discuss different ideas. Okay, so because this is midterm, you've got 3 things due this weekend. Okay, now let's take a look. All right, wise guys. So in the early 1940s, many studios tried to create characters that were just smart aleck stars. They wanted, you know, a front runner that was hilarious, that was getting into trouble, that was very smart. And these guys really triumphed at this time. You know, a lot of tension was built around the war and a lot of time and energy were focused on the war. So having this kind of minimal getaway from your thoughts and a time that you could just enjoy something else and get lost in a character or a cartoon became really important. So Hanna and Barbera are going to be somebody that we're going to talk, well, 2 people that we're going to be talking about later in the term, but I want you to take note at them currently. Tom and Jerry came out around this time. This is Puss Gets the Boot. From 1940. The thing that's different about a verbal vacation home, you always have the whole place to yourself. From the short, it's not the full short, and you're going to kind of see as we get a little bit into the upcoming weeks, it's harder to find full episodes online. I am going to work on trying to find good quality clips, but... Puss Gets the Boot is telling a tale of Jasper, the house cat, and being warned not to break chinaware, aka the dishes in the house. And then a mouse tries to make the cat run a fool. The theme wasn't anything crazy or unheard of or, you know, special, but it's what the animators were able to do with it that made the big difference. So William Hanna and Joseph Barbera worked underneath Rudy Ising, and really what happened here was just people working together, being successful, and kind of hitting something big. So Hanna designed the cat and mouse that were lifelike enough that when somebody was watching them, you could kind of feel their pain and imagine them being lifelike animals, and they became cartoon stars. It was like a slapstick humor that people felt like they could feel while watching. So Jasper ends up becoming Tom in The Midnight Snack, and Jerry becomes Jerry instead of just a random mouse. Now, it does take Tom and Jerry several years to hit their stride and become very popular. In the beginning, you can see, and I kind of tried to pause it here, that Tom was over-detailed. And, you know, like they would turn his whiskers into a mustache. It was great to give facial details to show emotion, but it became very difficult to actually animate with.
And here is that midnight snack.
Don't forget about spelling and grammar mistakes. Just click on the highlighted area.
And again, these are in parts. So if you are interested, you can always click on this one and then watch part two and part three. We're still dealing, sorry to keep pausing it. We're still dealing in Technicolor here. Technicolor is, you know, until today. And then Metro Goldwyn Mayer, MGM Studios. All right.
You created a business.
I know. I'm setting it up. You now have to watch the rest to know what happens. All right. So then lastly, we have Yankee Doodle Mouse. So I posted these three different ones. Let me get this up for a second. Tom and Jerry. Promise I won't do over time. Okay, here we go. Directed by William Hanna and Joseph Barbera. Tom and Jerry. So take a look at the three clips that I have and then try to see what you're noticing between the three. About style and how they've developed throughout the years. I mean, these two are only 1 year apart and then 2 years after, but a lot of refinement and adjustments have been made. All right, so Tom and Jerry, very popular, took them a little bit. Another really common, I would hope that you have all already heard of them, is Woody Woodpecker. And Woody Woodpecker is Walter Lantz. That's a name that we've been hearing, you know, for some time now. It's really interesting to see all these key players and how they kind of come in and out. So Woody was not only original, but he had an effect on his surroundings. So like Daffy Duck and Bugs Bunny were born into kind of this like screwy environment that already existed. But in contrast, and by Walter Lantz's choosing, he still kind of used those childish themes and cuteness, and Woody was kind of put into this innocent atmosphere and kind of created this huge contrast against it. So Woody's debut is in Knock Knock. All right, so, you know, Woody Woodpecker was a kind of insane, crazy bird, and obviously with his catchphrase, it became very popular. And again, as we're looking through all of these, seeing what humor was then versus now, I mean, even just looking back 5-10 years ago at what cartoons were doing to be funny versus now is something really interesting to look at. So the Barber of Seville, this is one of Woody Woodpecker's most famous, shorts, and it pushed the envelope in many ways. You'll see what goes on in it but music is going to become faster, and the story crew, had not reflected the speed up in the action. So then the director decided to do so, matching every Figaro to a new jump cut. The result was the fastest, funniest scene that had ever been done in a Woody Woodpecker Lantz cartoon. The fact that the woodpecker swung a mean razor was not lost in the humor either. So for this one, there will be a quiz question on it. But we're going to run into some copyright issues. So take a look at this full.
Wait! Did you download?
Full short here. Waltz Lance. So interesting with the music, the singing, also some racial issues in earlier animation. All right, so there are so many important artists that were working during this time, and I just do not have time. I mean, this course would need to be so many extra weeks. But Norman McLaren, we looked at earlier with the allegory, the kind of replacement animation to music. But he was known as the poet of animation. Again, abstract, dealt with music. John Hallis animated instructional films in England. He learned from George Powell, who worked on the Puppet Toons. Did some really interesting animation work. David Han was animating in all different countries. He was working in 1919 and eventually directed Snow White. I'm not even going to pronounce Hans's last name because I don't think I would do it justice, but look him up. German animator that worked on many projects during the war. A lot of countries were animating shorts during this time. Don't forget that people were trying to show pride in their country through animation. Obviously, propaganda. The Soviet State Film Committee produced the first Soviet animated film, Soviet Toys, so something to look at. And then Japanese animation was mainly military propaganda. But, you know, I kind of focus on the United States a little bit more and kind of just the big key players, but there were a lot of things going on at this time. So don't think that this is all that was happening during this time. So then we're going to get into post-war, and there were new directions for Disney and for a lot of the different animation companies. So Donald Duck. So let me rewind. After the war, Disney had to regroup. Full-length narrative features in particular, Peter Pan, Alice in Wonderland, and Lady and the Tramp had been all put on hold. Time was going to be needed to produce them. Their government contracts, you know, where they were making all the shorts for the government and getting a lot of money for them, had ended. And money was very, very tight yet again. So Disney decided, you know what? We need to play up to our strengths. We need to play animated shorts. Now, Donald Duck had become a real star during the war. And they ended up making 8 new Donald Duck shorts. Here is one example. Donald's Dilemma, 1947. All right. And in honor of good old Donald, I am going to make duck my keyword for the week. Okay. So, Walt decided that he needed to stick with entertainment films, and he canceled his contracts for industrial, commercial, and educational films during this period. It was a really bold move because the studio really needed income from these. There are a couple that he did, like for Westinghouse Electric, Hand Tools, General Motors, and all of that. And everything that Disney did, you know, he tried to do it to the best of his ability. So none of these shorts, none of these commercials or anything that were anything less than beautiful. The story of menstruation from 1946, was made for Kotex, and it was the last commercial film the studio made for some time. This short was shown in high school girls' classes for decades. And again, it is very high standards of animation and style. It wanted to be artistic and informational. And this was Disney's strong suit. He knew that animated shorts were going to kind of be on their way out. And money was in feature production. So he needed to find new ideas. But before he got there, we're just going to take a little look at this.
Short, some tall, some heavy, and some slight. But there comes a time somewhere between the ages of 11 and 17, though about 13 is average, when the pituitary must turn part of its attention to maturing the body which it has grown. So it starts sending out a new type of hormone, a maturing hormone. And that is when menstruation begins. When these maturing hormones start coming down through the bloodstream to the ovaries. The ovaries themselves are glands about the size of almonds, and locked within each ovary are thousands of eggs.
You guys can watch the whole thing on your own time, but I do want you to see, like, imagine this is a 10-minute short about, you know, what happens to your body, and you saw the glands. It's very informative. But again, Disney tried to make the visuals very appealing. And this is something that we're still using today. You know, anytime you have a presentation, anytime you're dealing with information, we generally try to find visuals that really seal the deal, make things stick, keep you invested and interested.
Get chilled or to catch cold. And as for the old taboo against exercise, that's nonsense. Exercise is good for you during menstruation. Just use common sense. When you come to think of it, most of your daily routine...
All right. So then, again, Disney decided, you know what? I know where the money is. Because being the businessman that he was, and he took a risk in releasing his first live-action short. It was a documentary. So again, at this period in time, Disney did a live-action documentary. It was supposed to be a series, and it was called A Walt Disney True Life Adventure. Disney had great plans for his studio, and the post-war period was a transitional time that allowed him to look back and consider any previous mistakes and make any changes that Disney saw fit. I just want to show you kind of a style of the time. So Ichabod Crane and Mr. Toad was part of Package Pictures in the 1940s. So just kind of look at the style, look at the lighting, see what you think. This is a short clip from the film.
Thank you.
And again, you can continue to watch more of this. But this, you know, these kind of short series that Disney was working on at this time allowed him to explore different options. Okay. Ichabod and Mr. Toad was known for how scary it was. Disney didn't really go this dark or this scary, so it was like out of the blue, all of a sudden dealing with almost horror. Okay? So, Disney continued some features, live actions, live action films. And at this time, there was something called the United Productions of America. There was a Disney strike by the Screen Cartoonist Guild, and it was a defining moment for American animation in more ways than one. The most important that we're going to talk about here is the birth of the United Productions of America. It was the most innovative studio at this time, and it was known mainly for Mr. Magoo. So, John Hughley worked on Mr. Magoo here. Ragtime Bear is probably the most famous Mr. Magoo cartoon. So let's take a look at this one. I am going to run into some copyright. So watch this one and then come back. You know, and as we're watching these and seeing the different companies that they're coming from and the different animators that are doing it, pay attention again to the exaggeration, the squash and stretch, the timing, how they really seal the deal with the humor of the time. All right, so wise guys, continue on. After the war, Warner Brothers also entered a creative and expansive period. We got new characters, Pepe Le Pew, Sylvester the Cat, and Tweety Bird, all done by animators that you guys are familiar with. So I want you to take a look at these three shorts. I did have to pull from a couple different websites, so let me just make sure here. Adorable Kitty, you'll just want to scroll down. Do a quick look and then I'll stop it so you can watch it. So you can watch the whole thing, but basically a skunk mistaking a hopeless cat as the object of his unrequited affection, and then Sylvester. You can continue watching this one, but I just wanted to make sure you all saw at least that clip. And then Tweety with Bob Clampett. Bob Clampett had been making shorts with Tweety in the past, but But in 1947, Sylvester and Tweety Bird got together in cartoons. So we are going to have a little copyright issues, so just make sure to watch this clip. It's a short, short clip from the actual episode. Okay? During this time, many, many characters were created. Some were successful, some were not. Pretty, you know, typical, you know, you got to kind of make several characters to get one hit. Roadrunner and Coyote. These became kind of an instant hit. I'm sure you are familiar with them. They, you know, pushed the boundaries yet again with what they claimed to be humorous. You know, anvils to the face and getting up and getting hit by something else. It was a very exaggerated time, and they were constantly just like overwhelming with what could happen. It, you know, wasn't just one gag or one thing that happened. It was several on top and fast moving. And once we got the laugh, we got to keep it going. Big exaggeration. Let you watch the rest of that one too. So here's a quote from Tex. We gum things up to the point where we could get twice as much stuff in a cartoon from getting one situation right into another. A guy would no sooner get hit with an anvil than he takes one step over and falls into a well. Keep him going and it builds it for your audience. Tex would go on to do two other very famous cartoons. I'm going to run to copyright with these ones, so I want you to watch them. Blitz Wolf was an anti-Nazi parody of the Three Little Pigs, where the wolf was a goose named Adolf. And again, think about the time period, think about the characters, animation style, fluidity, and then, you know, who would watch this and what would their thoughts be on this? What made this, you know, something that was successful? And then Tex also did Red Hot Riding Hood. This was kind of... this was definitely a different type of cartoon. You know, again, we'd been focused on children. Maybe there were some adult themes, things like that. But this version of Red Hot Riding Hood obviously made Little Red into a more attractive, sexy type of character. And this is what kind of influenced Jessica Rabbit in Roger Rabbit. And we'll see, moving forward, other adult-type animations.
Daddy,
I want a diamond ring. I want some bracelets and everything. Daddy, you better get the best for me. Won't I look swell in sables, clothes with Paris labels, Daddy? You better get the best for me. Hey, Peter! I want the Empire State.
And again, this is just a shorter clip, but you can look up different clips. Avery ended up leaving theatrical cartoons in 1955 and began working on commercials. But until 55, really knew how to rock animations. So now we have La Rosa de Baghdad, Italy's first feature cartoon and first film of any type to be created in Technicolor. So that was really exciting. It was created and directed by a top Italian advertising designer who owned his own company, and the company worked on this film for 7 years. I actually have the whole film here. You do not need to watch the whole thing. If you are interested, you are obviously more than welcome to. It was shown in the Venice Film Festival in 1949.
Vidi Be, ministro della salute pubblica, per conto suo era sempre ammalato. Tonco, zirco e Didi.
Something just really interesting about the style and their use of color.
Arovai fatti onore. E ricordati che tuo padre era un grande musico.
Penserò a lui e anche a te, mamma bella.
And again, this was the first film, animated, live action, all of the above, to come from Italy and use Technicolor. Now, Waking Sleeping Beauty, this is a documentary. The full documentary is on Disney Plus. I really wish I could show you the full documentary. This talks about later periods in Disney, but you know, Disney really had some golden times, and this is kind of looking at one of those times. 10 years that created modern animation. And the crew that was behind it. You know, a lot of this was not only about the animation, but the music, the storytelling abilities, of course, mixed with the animation that Disney has had for, you know, 50 plus years by this time. So this was also post Disney's death, well, Walt's death. The studio was being owned by other people. There was a lot of drama. So you can read through this. Here's a little snippet of the trailer.
But here it starts. He starts establishing the rhythm. Clams pick it up and oysters and eating off and lobsters, whatever.
At the Walt Disney Studios from 1984 to 1994, a perfect storm of people and circumstances changed the face of animation forever. But it almost never happened.
Here it is, April 9th, 1980. This is the pass to all you folks out there. And we're going to go inside and see what it's like. Come on.
Revisions. 100 drawings go in the trash.
The fact is that the last couple of animated movies made were not particularly good.
That year, we were beat out at the box office by the Care Bears movie. We knew we hit rock bottom when the studio told us that we were being kicked out of our own building.
I think after that meeting, we all kind of said, we're going to make great films.
The work was intense, the hours were long, and there was only one thing that could stop it all. Margaritas.
This crew is the best crew. It's fabulous. Can you really do what you want to do in animation?
We have to do it in this company. That is our legacy.
From the producer of The Lion King and Beauty and the Beast comes the true story of the players.
Hi, Tim.
This is Tim Burton.
And who are you?
I'm John Lasseter.
He's the cameraman.
And the passion.
The real heartbeat of this company was, is, and will always be the film business.
That fueled one of the greatest comebacks in entertainment history.
And the winner is Beauty and the Beast.
Told by the people who were actually there.
We were a group of artists living the dream. We went from hitting rock bottom to creating the most successful films ever. This is the story of how we got there.
Waking Sleeping Beauty.
Highly, highly, highly recommend. Even just watching the trailer, I get pumped up. You may not have known that Tim Burton worked there. Yes, the same Tim Burton that you're thinking of. John Lasseter, who would be known for Pixar. There's just, again, people that made huge differences in animation, in history. Howard Ashman, I found this to be, it's a bonus feature, but recommend. So take a look.